Today we'll be talking about Guillermo del Toro and At the Mountains of Madness, another one of my favourite stories by American science fiction and horror writer H P Lovecraft. Primarily at why At the Mountains of Madness has been an off-and-on story to tell on the big screen for many years now, and one that may never see the big screen, unfortunately. To give you the short answer, it's because the concepts and themes of Lovecraftian stories tend to be difficult to pull off in a visual medium, as they work best in the theatre of the mind. See my other video, Concepts of Horror in Fiction, for an overview. First of all, out of all the directors working in Hollywood these days, Guillermo del Toro represents the best chance for a successful film rendition of the story. Why? Because apart from being an avid lover of Lovecraft's works, and other writers who follow in his steps, he has worked in the industry of horror, mystery, and modern fantasy for practically his whole career, from Pan's Labyrinth, to Hellboy, to The Strain. But will At the Mountains of Madness ever become a reality? That's a difficult question to give a straight answer to, but we'll at least try to discuss it here today. A lot of people say that the story is unfilmable. This is partly true, and partly incorrect. It's partly true because Lovecraftian concepts tend to fall short when given a visual representation in our cinemas and TV screens. It's also partially true because of the way the filmmaking industry has been leaning these past few years, especially in the way they are changing content to fit certain broadcasting standards or views. Let's tackle the Lovecraftian concepts first, though. In Lovecraftian tales, the protagonist drives the story forward but eventually becomes insignificant to the themes and ideas that get revealed in the narrative. When this gets revealed to the audience, we become aware of them being primarily a framing device for our own point of view, our perspective, our glimpse into the horror of Lovecraftian worlds. This idea, being small and inconsequential in a grand universe of things, also applies to the impossibility of Lovecraftian horror, especially the many creatures, demigods, and godlike creations. This is because that's all they are, ideas. They are ideas of existential terrors, directly representing that human fear we all share of our smallness in the universe. The idea that while we have all of these systems of science, of religion, of the way the world should work, and what happens when we die, are wrong, or at least don't include everything they should, because if such an entity as Cthulhu exists, where does that leave God? Science? History? These concepts are inherently difficult to explore on the big screen due to their immensity, being philosophical or ideological in nature, and also their impossibility of narrowing down what they are due to them being ideas in essence. One could say that, as stated before, they are mainly things perceived by the framing protagonists or protagonists. How do we show this in cinemas? This is mostly open to creative license, but that's the problem. It has been tried in several movies, which are difficult to get a hold of these days or even find online, but haven't really had the same impact as they did in their written form. That's due to writing being open to interpretation, to the individual perceiving the thing in their mind's eye. How do you make something impossible real? In my opinion, this was done excellently in John Carpenter's The Thing and In the Mouth of Madness. The practical effects had a weight to them, and while they were up to the creative license of the art department on their actual appearances, the weight that they did have in the physical world really made them stand out on screen, as well as the madness brought about by the truth of the situation and other ideas was done well through the characters, who were inconsequential to the story. More of a framing device for us, the audience. And these difficulties are further compounded by the fact that the industry has been changing these days, wanting to shoehorn certain things like happy endings, love stories, and romances, changing elements of stories for certain audiences, for example. But this doesn't work with Lovecraftian horror, thriller, or modern fantasy. Lovecraftian concepts don't usually have a happy ending, or at least its happy endings aren't what the global audience would consider a happy ending. While not Lovecraftian, Shutter Island has a perfect example of this. Spoiler ahead in about 5 seconds, so please stop watching if you don't want the twist from being revealed. In Shutter Island, the protagonist, Teddy Daniels, does indeed have a breakthrough in discovering the truth, just like a Lovecraftian character. His truth being that he murdered his wife for her killing their children by drowning them in the lake. However, the character hides this from the authorities, and instead chooses to die in a lie rather than living with the truth, being lobotomized due to hiding his breakthrough with the doctors. This, in my mind, is the same as the Lovecraftian hero. Even though they may succeed in learning something or survive an ordeal, the status quo and the normal world are never the same again, usually tainted by the truth they've uncovered, always for the worse, usually leading towards madness. As you can see, this isn't really what you'd call a happy ending, and this is the same with a love interest or a romance too. At the Mountains of Madness is about the story of two men discovering the horrific aftermath of an attack on their main research camp, attempting to uncover the mystery of what happened, leading to bigger, more horrifying truths that not only shatter their reality, but also force them to return home and try to stop scientific communities and archaeological institutions from furthering their own investigation there, for fear that the things there and the knowledge there will endanger all of humanity. There isn't room for a romantic interest here, not really. Movie studios want to include one because they think it'll register with a wider audience. In my opinion, this is condescending to us as an audience. I think we're intelligent enough to not need a romantic interest for us to have a more vested interest in a given story. This is why I have high hopes for The Lighthouse and The Colour Out of Space. I'll leave links in the former trailers in the description. Changing elements of the story has been pretty much done with every single bloody story you find these days that has been adapted from a short story or a novel. Examples include Ghost in the Shell, Altered Carbon, and the latest, Netflix's upcoming Witcher series. Changing character backgrounds, ethnicities, and most likely, although not revealed yet, stories themselves. I won't go into what they've changed and why some of the things were controversial, especially for the fanbase of these original stories. A simple Google search will help you uncover that. But they were changed to apparently update, modernize, or make them more relatable, rather than just to say make them inclusive of certain ethnicities or backgrounds. Again, I'm not saying anything bad here. If an actor fits the role, then that's bloody fantastic. The problem is when they actually interfere with the world building that the original writer has done. There's reasons why these characters are the way they are, look the way they are, that are not related to political or ideological inclinations of the writer. This is related to the pure bloody storytelling and building of a world that is unique to that world and to that writer. And don't get me started on the last season of Game of Thrones. Overall, I think that creating on-screen narratives that explore Lovecraftian concepts of horror, science fiction, knowledge and truths, revelation, and everything else we've discussed here today is inherently difficult and would need a visionary who truly understands these concepts and why they need to be the way they need to be, without shoehorning things in that will ultimately weaken the story, making it a pile of garbage. And I truly think that Guillermo del Toro is that kind of visionary, that kind of director. He has a passion for storytelling and a penchant for Lovecraft. Who else could make At the Mountains of Madness a cinematic masterpiece, a reality? If you've enjoyed the discussion in today's video, let me know in the comments below, as I'll always love to hear what you think as I make this content for you. Also, please like, subscribe, and click on the alarm bell icon so you'll be notified when a new video is released. I'm planning on doing more visual essays like this, book and film reviews, podcasts and interviews, and talking about storytelling and filmmaking, going over gear, tools and techniques you can use to further your own skills and ideas when it comes to telling stories. Also, if you think any of my videos would be helpful to someone, please share them and post them where you think they would be appropriate. It'll help me out a ton and it'll help to build a community so we can have bigger discussions on bigger topics. I'll see you in the next one.